the Cliche Club, where you have new fun with old sayings, is now in session. Wielding the gavel over tonight's transcribed, unrehearsed, and ad-lib game time is ABC's Man About Radio Club President, Walter Kiernan.
Thank you, Recording Secretary Les Griffith, and welcome friends and members to another meeting of the Cliche Club. Ready to hunt in the cliche game tonight, we have Carolyn Gilmer, who pioneered the cliche game.
Walter, you make me feel so old, sort of like a pioneer woman.
Carol, dear, tonight we shall make you feel not a day older than you want to feel. Fine. Ed Hill, an uncommon fast man, a treeing and escaping cliche.
You should have seen the ones that got away, Walter.
I think sometimes I think Ed Hill uses a Geiger counter. No, I never know why anybody.
Geiger counter.
Frederick Lewis Allen, who is the amateur title holder at 135 pounds, I believe, in the cliche freestyle division.
That was last year before I put on 15 pounds, Walter. I used to be a sprinter. Now about a quarter of a mile is my distance.
All the best that fit to sprint now. And as our special guest, author, lecturer, painter, entertainer, editor, Miss Gypsy Rose Lee. Author, lecturer, painter, entertainer, editor. I'm not quite sure I covered all your talents.
You covered me enough, honey. Too much.
Covered you enough.
May I take off my jacket at that?
Yes. And Mr. Allen, put yours on. And here's how we play the cliche game, Miss Lee and audience. I tell stories sent in by our listening friends, and in each story are clues to hidden cliches, old hat expressions, familiar phrases, proverbs, old saws, which you and our three members are to guess within 2 minutes after the story has been told. Now, since that seems clear, we will get in action as soon as we have some words from Mr. Griffith.
And my words, Mr. President, are for the listening audience. Friends, if we use your story, you'll receive the latest and most complete Rand McNally Cosmopolitan World Atlas. And if Miss Lee and our members don't discover your hidden cliche, you will be awarded an attractive and handsome Whitnor watch, a distinguished member of the Longines Whitnor family of fine watches.
A lovely family. Very good, Mr. Secretary. Now, Miss Lee, Miss Gilmer, Mr. Hill, Mr. Allen, let us cliche into action with the first story sent to us by Mr. Henry H. Peck of Kenmore. A man can't pronounce a letter. Henry H. Peck of Kenmore, New York. Mr. Peck receives a Rand McNally Atlas for his contribution, which is an often used comment. Audience, for the first story, our recording secretary will tell the listening audience the answer in advance, just to give our new listeners an idea of how the game works. After that, you will be on your own. So our members in the clubroom cannot hear our recording secretary as he tells you and the radio audience the answer to the first story.
The hidden cliche in this story is he kept his wits about him. That's right, he kept his wits about him.
Once upon a time, this is an often used comment. Oh, look at those bright, eager faces over there. Once upon a time, there was a king who wanted to be the merriest, happiest, best-humored ruler in the world. Therefore, he hired a lot of extra court jesters. Miss Lee's hand is up already. Oh, you were just waving at a friend, I see. Miss Lee, you've thrown me over. He hired a lot of extra court jesters, had them entertain him in 8-hour shifts, night and day. There was always a jester at his right hand to tell the latest joke, a funster at his left hand, punning away for dear life, comic sitting at his feet, making bright remarks. Miss Lee? Yeah?
Uh-huh.
You have it?
I think so.
What is it?
Well, if it isn't, the more the merrier it should be.
It should be. It isn't.
It isn't?
It isn't.
Well, you want me to go now, or?
That's right. No, you stay right there. Mr. Hill is going to have a go at this.
Couldn't be house tricks.
House tricks? No. Oh, he had a funster at his left hand, punning away, comic sitting at his feet. Jesters constantly on hand to keep him in a merry mood.
Wouldn't be anything for a laugh, only we did that last week.
Yes, and it got a laugh, as I recall it.
Well,
so we did anything for a laugh, and we got it.
It really should be the more the merrier. I don't...
No, jester at his right hand, funster at his left hand, comic sitting at his feet. He kept his wits about him.
Oh. Oh, we should have had that.
Sure.
That's an easy one.
That's a cliche?
Yes.
Okay, as long as I'm initiated.
And Mr. Henry Peck of Kenmore, New York, Miss Lee, for fooling the members with his story. He kept his wits about it. We will send a handsome Whitnor watch. Congratulations, Mr. Peck.
That was your baptism of fire, Miss Lee.
Congratulations, Miss Lee.
I know we'll really get the next one here. This will be no problem at all. This is a slang expression. We don't tell the audience this, and we don't tell the audience anymore. They guess, too. They play, too. Miss White, Miss Jessica White, Glens Falls, New York. Miss White tells about this fellow who's been married for several years, and in every way, his wife is a perfect helpmate, except that she doesn't mend his socks. She keeps the buttons sewed on his shirts, has his suits cleaned and pressed when necessary, does his laundry perfectly, slaves over a hot stove, does everything a good wife should, but she refuses to fix his socks. Be kind of, Mr. Hill?
Well, this isn't it, but it occurs to me that these are the times to try men's souls.
Try men's socks. That's it. And I have holes in them, too. No, that's just Miss Lee.
The more the merrier?
You keep saying that, and you're going to hit it tonight.
Well, that's what I thought.
Before the evening's over.
Hit till you win is a little axiom in my business.
Mr. Ellis?
She doesn't give a darn?
She doesn't give a darn.
Oh.
Well, Miss Lee and members, let's see what you do with this next story. It comes to us from Mrs. Miss Lee, you're so cute when you miss even. We love to have you miss him. Comes to us from Mrs. Richard Devine, Pleasantville, New York. She receives an atlas for her offering. It's a slang expression. Slang expression. A young writer was very happy when he landed a magazine job writing biographical profiles. And in his first assignment on Kaiser Wilhelm, he did a bang-up job. Did fine also on his next two, Shakespeare and President Taft. But he began to feel a little uneasy when he was assigned to do a piece about William Jennings Bryan, followed by one on William S. Hart. Miss Gilmer?
Beginning to sound like a will of iron, only that is getting the will in.
You've got the will in, if you can put something else with it. Mr. Hill?
Couldn't meet the bills.
Well, he couldn't meet these bills, no. Most of them had been interred happily long before. But you're both sort of going in the right direction. Perhaps a few more lines will give it to you. He struggled through those write-ups, went on to the poet Wordsworth, did William Allen White.
He was ready, willing, and able.
He was ready, willing, and able, practically. You're really going in the right direction. He did the baseball player Willie Keeler. He did Willie Howard. Began to wonder if this wasn't more than just a coincidence. Miss Gilmer?
He had the willies.
He had the willies. That will do it. They gave him the willies, actually. Miss Lee, I thought you might get that.
Well, I was thinking
editorial.
Of Walk Me Around Again, Willie.
That would have been good.
That's as close as I could get to Willie. That Willie, I mean. Not that I haven't noticed.
Being in the writing trade, I thought you might know. You are a new editor, aren't you?
That's right, I am,
What's your new job?
Well, I'm not just exactly an editor.
Well, we know that.
I'm editor-in-chief, and I'm circulation manager. My circulation is very good, fortunately.
Yes, it is.
I'm also advertising manager. And I'm the secretary for all three of these people. I was elected editor of the AGVA News. That's my theatrical union, and that's going to be our new newspaper.
American Guild Variety.
That's right.
Very, very good. Are you going to do a column?
I think I will.
Yes. Well, now that you've tackled three stories so far, let us forge ahead. We send a Rand McNally Atlas to Mrs. Esther Myers of Chicago, Illinois, whose story is a commonly used term. Mrs. Myers tells about a fishing trip she went on with a girl who had the finest and most expensive equipment on the boat. But all she did was show it around and have everybody admire it. Is this a fishing stuff? Well, she also managed to call attention to her new hairdo, which the others agreed was very becoming. And practically every hour, this girl changed clothes. Each outfit seemed more dazzling than the last, and everyone told her so. She caught no fish, but she had a wonderful time. Oh, she had the most expensive equipment. But changed her hairdo so often and changed her clothes so often.
Of course, if there were a fish called a place, as I believe there is, it could be all dressed up and no place to go.
Yes, it could be.
Pretty
there was a fish called a
place.
And I didn't know that there was. It could be, but that is not quite it. She didn't seem very much interested in fish. Caught no fish, but she had a wonderful time. Went along
There's a catch in this somewhere.
Yes,
I think it has something to do with lure, hasn't it?
It has indeed.
Lure.
It's, She's flying the lure, but not for fish, so far as I can see by this story. She caught no fish. What are you using tonight, Ed? She was fishing for compliments.
Oh.
You seem pretty far away from that, Mr. Kiernan.
Did you lie down on that? Should we?
No, I can learn to like it, I guess.
I don't see where a lure fits into that at all.
Well, the clothes were the lure. You want to fight?
Oh, no, not necessarily. I'm just
well, I just wondered, because nothing special to do for the next hour.
Just visiting.
Well, you missed on fishing for compliments, which means our recording secretary must make his award.
And I'm happy to do so, Mr. President. Mrs. Esther Myers of Chicago, Illinois, will not have to go fishing for compliments when she receives her attractive Whitnor watch for stopping the members with her story. Congratulations, Mrs. Myers.
Annapolis to Mrs. Michael Doyle of New York City for her story, which is a familiar phrase. This one calls for sound effects. So I call on Keen Crockett. It also calls for a bit of a brogue. So I call on myself for that. For 30 years. Oh, this is natural, you know. I don't have to try this. For 30 years, Officer Martin Clancy had been one of the city's finest. And Officer Clancy loved walking his beat. To him, the precinct was his second home. He knew every inch of the neighborhood. And so when Officer Martin Clancy retired from the force, it was fitting and proper. They should assign his beat to Officer Martin Clancy, Jr. No, wasn't that nice, Miss Gilmer?
He was following in his father's footsteps.
He was following in his father's
footsteps.
I wonder, do many people follow in their father's footsteps today? I didn't. How about you, Mr. Hill?
No, I didn't.
Well, I'm following in mine, as a matter of fact. Speaking of cliches, although I did it, didn't I?
You said you would not say, as a matter of fact.
I would not say a matter of fact, and I did it. But my father was a newspaper man. He is a newspaper man.
Mm-hmm. There still is?
So I'm following in his footsteps.
In a more silent way.
Think,
yes.
That would be footprint, sort of, getting...
Yeah, let's toy around with that for a while. Footprint.
Yes.
Mr. Allen, did you follow in your dad's?
No, indeed. No, my father was a parson, and I just preach in print.
Sure.
What the hell? So, Miss Kiernan, Miss Lee has a most attractive young son named Eric, I believe. And I asked just before we came on the program how old he was, and I learned that he was 5 years old. And that reminded me of a cliche, because every time I think of Eric now, I shall think of a very well-known American boxer.
Yes?
Young Stripling.
Miss Lee does not think that's funny.
I don't think it's funny because I've been listening to it for 5 years.
Well, anybody following your footsteps, Mr. Secretary?
Before you go on, I'd like to remind our listening friends to keep sending us their stories. And don't forget, friends, send us as many stories as you wish. And don't worry if you've got a new story on a cliche we've already used. Send it along, too. We'll welcome twice-told cliches. All right, Mr. President, it's all yours.
Well, this is a common expression usually used to explain a maneuver. The scene is the locker room at halftime of the big football game. It's a little warm for it this year, I think. That has nothing to do with it. The coach is talking to his players. He says, listen, you guys, we got to win this game, and there's only one way we can do it. We got to stop their center, Sokolotovsky. He's been the fifth man in our backfield all afternoon. But most of all, he's been breaking up our best running play, our spinner down the middle. Smith, I'm putting you in at left end this half. Jones, you're in at the other wing. All you two got to do the rest of the game is to get Sokolotovsky out of the way. Now get out there, men, and show them the old fight. Smith and Jones, I'm counting on the two of you to get that man. Miss Gilmer?
There'll be little left of center.
Good, but not it, Mr. Allen.
Well, he was hoping to make both ends meet in the near vicinity of this.
Is that very close, Fred, Miss Gilmer?
He was playing both ends against the middle.
He was right. He was. And so Rand McNally Atlas goes to Mr. Frank Attucks of Washington, D.C. for his story, which is a common expression usually used to explain a maneuver. That was a very good maneuver, I think. Now we get on to the next story, for which Mr. C.H. Dorman of Houston, Texas, get the Rand McNally World Atlas, the hidden cliche. Ed Gorman of Houston, Texas, get the Rand McNally World Atlas, the hidden cliche is a famous quotation. And just a warning, the quotation is not of present-day origin. The mothers of a group of teenagers gave their children a potluck picnic, agreed to supply the punch and soft drinks. When the lunch boxes each of the youngsters had prepared were opened, they all turned out to have the same kind of dessert. The mothers were puzzled, but not the kids. The kids said, well, natch, everybody knew everybody was coming, and what else would they make? The mothers felt that they should have done a better job of planning for the meal. But there was nothing to do but let the kids eat what they had brought to the picnic. Mr. Hill?
Let them eat cake.
Let them eat cake. Well, this next one, oh, Miss Lee, this is a cinch for you. It's right
I'll
down
bet.
Your boulevard.
I was just wondering if you'd like me to move over and make room for Ann Coriel.
Is she here?
The more the merrier.
No, right where you are. You're doing very well. This is an old chestnut of the entertainment world. And an atlas goes to Mrs. J. Sear, C-Y-R of Brooklyn, for sending it in. Miss Sear's story is about a friend of hers just back from a visit to Great Britain. Everywhere this woman went in England, Scotland, Ireland, Wales, she found that most smokers were rolling their own cigarettes. And being up on her cliches, this woman said to herself, when in the British Isles, do as the British Islanders do. So all the time she was there, she made her own cigarettes. We didn't buy the tailor-mades while she was there.
I wish you'd stop looking at me.
In the eyes. Well, I'm listening to them, but I'm looking at you.
I haven't the faintest idea about this game of yours. I'm just here for the low notes.
Fred, how about you on that?
It was roll them in the aisles.
Rolling them in the aisles.
Oh, that's it's been it. So long since I've done that. No wonder I didn't recognize it.
Well, Miss Lee, this may be very personal. I probably shouldn't even ask it. And I don't know how you feel about answering questions like this, but how did you happen to get started as an author?
Oh, me? Oh, I had my jacket off and I forgot I was an author. Well, it's rather a long story. You want to hear it all? How long are we on the air?
We have until next Thursday.
Well, I have short versions and long versions.
Okay. A short version.
Well, Walter Winchell asked me to do a column for him. And I rented a typewriter and learned how to play the typewriter first and then did the column. And I said, this is for me. And I had the typewriter for a full month anyway, so I started writing The Beastly Murders.
Mm-hmm. Are you working on any books now?
Yes, I am. I'm working on that carnival book, you know, little of it was in Flair magazine this month.
Yes, that was the one that fell out of Flair.
You couldn't have too much,
I guess. No, it didn't fall out of Flair, honey, because I personally saw to it that every copy was riveted in.
Went down and stitched everyone in,
I certainly did, honey, with my little darning needle. Well, I like Flair because it's the only magazine you can hang up.
Well, we'll hang up on that. Now, here's a popular saying. Mr. Martinson, Mr. R.R. Martinson in Brighton, Minnesota. Mr. Martinson says the other day something very amusing happened to him. But when he tried to tell anybody about it, he laughed so hard he couldn't say a thing. Even now, whenever he thinks of the incident, he practically goes into hysterics and becomes absolutely speechless. He has a very funny story to tell, but he still hasn't been able to tell it. He never can get to the end of the thing. It just kills him. And try as he might to phrase it, Ed.
Laugh, he thought he'd die.
No, that's a good thought. That's quite it. He just can't seem to get it into words. It just kills him every time he tries to finish the story himself.
Can't something for laughs. What is it?
No, that's not quite it, Mr. Hill.
Maybe he's at a loss for words.
No, Mr. Hill.
Too funny for words.
Too funny for words. That's it.
That was a build-up from Ed.
Wasn't it, though? Yes. Very good. Very good. Well, let's try the next one now. This is contributed by Mr. David Deutsch of Brooklyn. Brooklyn seems to be in the league tonight, all right. An atlas, of course, goes to Mr. Deutsch for sending his story to us. This is a proverb. History of a kind was made the day that all of the athletic teams at West Point competed against the Sing Sing prison aggregation. As it turned out, the Army football squad was no match for the Sing Sing 11, who overpowered the West Pointers with their stronger attack. In baseball, track, basketball, Miss Gilman?
The pen, you said, now wait a minute, Sing Sing won, isn't that right?
Sing Sing won.
So obviously the pen is mightier than the sword.
Right. right. The pen is mightier than the sword. Fred, you're not working on any new books at the moment. Oh, I know what you're working on.
Not a thing.
The 100th anniversary of Poppins.
I've been waiting. All this talk about Flair magazine.
Editor-in-chief of Harper's,
yes,
sitting here biting his nails.
Working on the centennial issue of Harper's that's coming out in October, and it's going to be tremendous.
100
and
years
old. And I saw all this talk about these other magazines.
You're not the original editor.
I'm not the original. Only the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, only the 6th in 100 years.
You recommend it for a long life.
Yes, it's really the easiest recipe for longevity that
it's
I know.
It's the downtown health cure.
That's it.
Get elected to the board of Harper's and live forever.
That's it.
And it's old enough to have a hole in it.
Very good, Miss Lee.
Thank you, Walter.
Story, we'll wait until the end of the story before giving your answer. No one asked. This is our Brooking No Interference number. It was sent to us by Miss Audrey Marrick of Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Oh, this is for you, Miss Gilmer.
Oh, don't say that.
Oh, the Tulsa Terror.
An
atlas to Miss Marrick, and her cliche is an old chestnut figure of speech. And, Miss Gilmer, this takes place in Oklahoma. Old chestnut figure of speech. Miss Marrick says that this happened recently out Oklahoma way during the political campaign, which is still going on. I believe a political campaign goes on forever in Oklahoma. One of the candidates had hardly begun his speech, said, "My friends and fellow constituents, I'm very happy to be here on this occasion tonight. I bring you a message, and I have so many things that I would like to tell you about, but we're having a little difficulty here. That man on the louder. I still would like to get my message across to you because I have so many things that are important for you. I come to you tonight, friend, over great difficulties, but still attempting to get my message through to you." That way, the speaker sure enough made himself heard.
Beat the band?
Miss Lee, he beat the band.
Hurry
up! Shouting to beat the band.
What?
Eureka! Water for Miss Lee.
I want to go now, if I may, please. And it's been wonderful being with you all.
Stay right here. That was wonderful. And you don't even come from Oklahoma, Miss Lee.
No, I've never beat a band in my life.
You've never been. That was wonderful. And you don't even come from Oklahoma, Miss Lee.
No, I've never beat a band in my life.
You've never beat a band, huh? You may put your coat on again. Now, let's see. What is a good word this time, Mr. Secretary? Oh, that's for Miss Merrick. Yeah, we'll finish with her. Oh, that's wonderful. Wonderful. You got in just before the short takes on that, Miss Lee. We have a number of short takes, and before we get to them, our recording secretary has some business with our listening friends.
Well, thank you, Mr. President. I'd like to remind our listeners to send in their cliche stories together with the answers to the Cliche Club, American Broadcasting Company, New York 20, New York. The Cliche Club, American Broadcasting Company, New York 20, New York. All contributions become the exclusive property of the Cliche Club, and we reserve the right to edit or alter them to suit the requirements of these meetings. Please limit your contributions to 200 words or less, and send us as many stories as you wish. Remember, all stories used on the Cliche Club are entirely fictitious, and the decisions of our judges are final. If your story is used at our meetings, you will receive the newest and most complete Rand McNally Cosmopolitan World Atlas. If your contribution is not yes, you will be awarded a truly fine Whitnor watch, made and guaranteed by the Longines Whitnor Watch Company as 1866 makers of watches of the highest character. And once again, speaking of characters, here's Walter Kiernan, our president.
Now for our condensed cliché stories, we call these short takes. One sentence, one guess. 30-second time limit. And by the way, if we use your short takes, whether they are guessed or not, you will receive one of the new sensational Evans automatic lighters. Short take from Mrs. Bessie Dixon of Norfolk, Virginia, an often used term. The mother and father join the children in Ring Around the Rosie. Oh, no one's going to get this. I give up on this one, and I got the answer. Miss Gilmer?
A family circle.
It is, yes. Oh, that was excellent.
Oh, I don't know how much money you're getting, honey, but you should get a raise.
And you should, too.
Oh, I'm going to get raised right out of here. I can see that coming.
For Mr. Bernard Rose of Van Nuys, California, an old hat phrase, not one person kept the secret. Not one person kept the secret. Not one. This is tough.
Not one person knows the answer.
Not one person knows the answer. Mr. Allen?
All told.
All told.
Oh, yes.
From Miss Elizabeth Flack of New York City, a somewhat flowery literary expression, they sat down on the sofa because his request was so courteous and tactful.
They couldn't take it standing up.
That's not very flowery, Miss Gilmer.
Now back to Bobby Breen speaking in California.
It was just a thought.
It was a thought. Oh, definitely it was a thought.
May I leave before you do, Miss Lee?
Oh, well, honey, I think the patrol wagons will be here to get both of us any moment.
No one has that 30 seconds limit. I think
about this.
What, Fred? What
was I was going to say... please be seated, or something about the terms it was couched in.
You were on the terms. It was couched in polite terms, but you were a little too late on it. So whoever's automatic lighter goes
couched
to Miss Black.
Couched in polite terms.
Mm?
Couched in.
Couched in polite terms, that was it. You were a little late, so New Evans automatic lighter goes to Miss Flack. I think we will send it without fluid, though, because you moved it in so quickly. We won't give her the entire lighter.
The fluid.
Oh, we'll drop the flame.
Let her have the fluid.
From Miss Barbara Constant of El Paso, Texas, a proverb. Miss Constant says, "My pal is a great help to me in preparing the bread for the oven." It's a pun.
Friend in need. Is
friend,
a
friend in
need.
Wonderful. Carol.
In preparing the bread for the oven, may I just hear, well, I don't get a friend in need preparing the bread for the oven. Where does this come from?
Well, friend in need, K-N-E-D-D.
I had been working...
Oh, need with a K, like me. Oh,
like me with extra letters.
Cunny is the way we say it. And cunny.
If we had started from the knee, we would have been ahead. From Victor Bartulis of Rochester, New York, a worn-out remark. It's flooded in back of the cornfield. It's flooded in back of the cornfield.
Up to my ears.
Up to your ears. Not unless you're standing knee deep in. No. You're very close, Ed. You're very close.
Oh. Wet behind the ears.
Wet behind the ears. That was it. All right, well, thank you, Miss Lee and members, for being on the Cliche Midway tonight. We hope to have you back again soon. And thank you, listening friends, for being with us. And a special thanks for all those fine letters. We're getting a wonderful mail on this program. And we're glad so many of you are enjoying this brand-new game. I'd like to suggest you play it yourselves at home. It's going to be a lot of fun. And, of course, I would like to suggest you be with us next week at the same time when transcribed Agnes Rogers will be here together with Miss Gilmer, Ed Hill, and our special guest will be the author and creator of Nero Wolf, Mr. Rex Stout.
And, of course, to wield a gavel over the destinies of the stories and guesses will be Cliche Club President Walter Kiernan.
Thank you, Recording Secretary Les Griffiths, and now friends and members, until next week at this same time, the Cliche Club stands adjourned.
Cliche Club is produced by David Yellen. George Weiss is our director, and story editor is Vera Lawrence. This is ABC, the American Broadcasting Company.